Senator Kipchumba Murkomen to second this motion.
What is it, Senator? Senator Wetangula?
Mr. Speaker, I take cognizance of the fact that my distinguished younger brother is running away from me today. And Mr. Speaker, I'm standing on... could you sit down, please? Mr. Speaker, I'm standing on Standing Order 100 in relation to your ruling that we end this debate at 12:30. Mr. Speaker, that standing order gives me and my counterpart an opportunity to address the House on a bill for at least not more than 60 minutes. Mr. Speaker, I want just to bring to your attention that the material I have, I intend to address the House on this matter for about 60 minutes. Now, if you say we are ending at 12:30, and I know there are many members who want to debate, and there are equally many members who are itching to vote, Mr. Speaker, it is important and imperative that those who are itching to vote can wait, and we debate this matter fully for the country to understand and appreciate what we are trying to visit to the country. And I intend to speak, Mr. Speaker, for 1 hour. So your direction that we end at 12:30 means that by 11:30, if I take the floor, nobody else will have an opportunity to speak, and that is not fair to the House either, Mr. Speaker. So we need a variation to that.
Order, members, order, proceed, Senator Murkomen to second, but I want to agree entirely with the minority leader. We will, something should be done, including persuading you not to exhaust your 1 hour. Order, members. Proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'd like to first of all appreciate the majority leader for eloquently, Mr. Speaker, moving this bill. Mr. Speaker, I beg to second. And Mr. Speaker, I'd like to say a few things. One is, Mr. Speaker, last week I didn't have the opportunity to congratulate you and congratulate this House, because we have demonstrated that we are a House of debate and that we are a sober House where, Mr. Speaker, consultations take place. We work towards bipartisan approaches. But, Mr. Speaker, we also respect the Constitution when it comes to the democracy that we have as a country. Mr. Speaker, I want also to thank you and to thank the committee, which I sit, Mr. Speaker, as a member of the Legal Affairs Committee, that, Mr. Speaker, the opportunity we had to listen to Kenyans, to listen to various Kenyans who appeared before us, who are not less than 59, Mr. Speaker, and to listen to the memoranda that came from them, it was a good opportunity for us to debunk some of the myths that, Mr. Speaker, have been debated out there that actually don't exist in the actual text of this bill. Mr. Speaker, we had presidential candidates before us. We had Senator James Orengo come before us. Mr. Speaker, we had ordinary Kenyans, people who are in civil society, people who are living their ordinary lives. Mr. Speaker, and we're very happy to say that we are making a decision today, having gone through the process of listening to Kenyans and having given them an opportunity for them to give their views on the bill, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this bill is very important, and I want to just point out a few things. First of all, there is the Kenyans have this impression that there was a bill to amend only Section 44 of the Elections Act. I had an opportunity, of course, to serve in the committee that was a joint committee of National Assembly and the Senate, led by Senator Kiraitu and Senator James Orengo. and I have therefore institutional memory of where we came from and where we now are. Mr. Speaker, I want to start by the education qualification. People who came here were very emotive when they were presenting on the amendment on education qualification.
Order, Senator, this is where I need to make the intervention because the point was raised. I think that matter has already been canvassed. You can deal with the remaining matters.
Mr. Speaker,
so that there is a position in terms of moving the
I know, Mr. Speaker, all the issues in the report have been canvassed. It's only that the various angles of the same issue need to be canvassed. Mr. Speaker, I really need to mention this about academic qualification. But Mr. Speaker, my view has been this. I was in the task force that worked on the laws that are related to devolution. What drove us that time to say there must be academic, some semblance of academic qualification for the MCAs was in the understanding that these were new systems of governance that was necessary that you have educated people to inform the debate in the finance committee, among others. Mr. Speaker, having reflected on this matter over time, and although this bill is postponing the qualification of a degree for another 5 years, Mr. Speaker, I have a different view. You know, when you go to an interview, you appear before the interviewing panel. Mr. Speaker, it's expected that those who interview you have similar or equal or even better qualification than yourself. Mr. Speaker, all of us who are seeking elective offices are appearing before Kenyan citizens who 80% do not have, or 70-80% don't have any academic qualifications. And Mr. Speaker, when the public participants came here to make presentation, I agree with them that if the interviewer, the person who's sitting in the panel making an interview, determining who is qualified, Mr. Speaker, does not have a degree, does not have any certificate, who are we to come here and legislate that that person is not qualified to run for office? And therefore, I agree with the members of public who come before us that in the fullness of time, we should scrap any academic qualification as a basis of entering into a public office. Let the citizens sit down and say, we want this year to vote someone who has a low degree. We want next year to vote someone who has no any degree. We want the other time to vote. Because, Mr. Speaker, it is them who have the decision, it is them who are the bosses, it is them who are making that decision, so that we stop this craziness and madness that public officers, leaders who have been elected, are running around buying degrees, Mr. Speaker. Some of them are telling us they did an exam, that, Mr. Speaker, at a day that you can be so sure he was having a nomination in his constituency or his county, but in the records it's indicated that he was sitting in an exam in a University X. And I want to encourage the Minister of Education to take this issue of reform of university very seriously. Because, Mr. Speaker, I have seen some people graduate with PhD, Mr. Speaker, but cannot write a single sentence, Mr. Speaker, cannot complete a sentence. And they are called Dr. So-and-so, cannot pronounce basic words, Mr. Speaker, that are supposed to be applied, because we have made, Mr. Speaker, education as an issue that looks so colorful to have the papers. So everybody is running around, you know, you are told somebody got a degree from Kampala, but Mr. Speaker, has never crossed, Mr. Speaker.
Order. Give Senator Professor Nyamapua the mic.
Mr. Speaker, you hear the way Senator Murkomen was eloquently and fluently trying to tell us that
order. People, what's your point of order?
My point of order, can he name the people he purports to have seen with the degrees that were purchased? Because you cannot dilute this house to that extent, or parliament or county assembly in Kenya.
Gamaliel was told in the Bible, are you the only man who is a stranger in Jerusalem? So, Mr. Speaker, I don't think Professor is the only Kenyan who is stranger in Kenya. There are leaders who are in court. There are leaders who are in court, Mr. Speaker, being prosecuted for having fake degrees. There are leaders, Mr. Speaker, who are in court being investigated for whether they even stayed in a classroom. So, Mr. Speaker, it's up to each one of us to do the research and find out whether. What I'm just trying to say
Order members, I agree completely with Senator Murkomen.
Yeah.
That's a biblical statement, if not a doctrine.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can only challenge me if you mention you in an adverse manner.
Yeah.
He did not mention names. Proceed.
So, Mr. Speaker, that is why I really needed to make that contribution, because we do not want leaders, persons who are in our office of power and influence, Mr. Speaker. We don't even know whether they had classmates in school. But Mr. Speaker, we don't want them to go and influence the university by trying to make that university cut shortcuts, Mr. Speaker, and hence reduce the quality of education in this country. So, Mr. Speaker, I totally agree with Kenyans who are saying in the long run, we need to do away with any academic qualification in public office. We are perhaps the only country in the world that requires academic qualification for any person to run for office.
What is this, Senator? Dr. Bon Galwale?
We should save time.
Mr. Speaker, the rules of debate are very clear, that members shall not be repetitive. Mr. Speaker, for a half an hour, the leader of the majority harped on the issue of education. Now, for 10 minutes, his deputy is doing precisely that. Mr. Speaker, is he in order to be repetitive, or is it a deliberate effort to play to the gallery so that the gallery thinks we came here to discuss qualifications of voters? We came here to discuss and sort out the mischief of Jubilee to want to bring manual voting instead of voting by technology. Mr. Speaker, is in order?
Order members, relax.
Yeah.
Every member here, and this is why I allowed second reading,
yeah.
Every member here will speak to a point or to various points. So if Senator Dr. Bon Galwale is obsessed with a particular contribution, that is yours. If the majority side is obsessed with another one, that is theirs. So everybody has a right to decide what to contribute on. But I want to agree with Senator Dr. Bon Galwale, and I want to repeat. The majority side and its deputy are running the danger of being repetitive. And in fact, I am concerned that the people who are praising illiteracy are the same people who have still the academic height to the very top. Proceed.
Mr. Speaker, it should go on record that myself and my senior, my boss, Senator Kindiki, both of us taught the University of Nairobi. But Mr. Speaker, I want to say that I want to come to the amendment of Article Section 44. Mr. Speaker, there have been too many myths, Mr. Speaker, about Section 44 of the Act. I request, Mr. Speaker, that my time be held if there will be too many point of orders.
What is this, Senator Kaniri?
Mr. Speaker, I rise understanding order number 30, paragraph 3A. Mr. Speaker, I rise understanding order 30, paragraph 3A. Mr. Speaker, given the interest that we have in this matter, and we want to debate it exhaustively, the time that we have, Mr. Speaker, as earlier noted by the Senate Minority Leader, may not be adequate. I want to move understanding order 30, paragraph 3A, that we do extend the sitting, this particular sitting, from 12:30 to 1:30. To 1:30, Mr. Speaker. Similarly,
order, Senator Kaniri. It
yes.
Helps to consult the chair.
Consult the chair.
Because there are already parallel consultations. I'm not refusing, but it's not fair to ambush the chair, especially on such a day.
So the chair
and will agree how to proceed, including appreciating the technicalities. We don't have to deal with all those issues in the plenary.
Mr. Speaker, I want to come to the most debated amendment on Section 44, and I want to just say three things. Number one, Mr. Speaker, there has been misguided debate out there that there is an amendment written somewhere that in case electronic voting fails, we go to manual. That is a lie, Mr. Speaker. There is no such a provision on Section 44. Section 44A says, Mr. Speaker, in case the PVR systems of transmission and identification fail, the Mass IBC must put place a complementary mechanism for identification of the voters and transmission of results. Mr. Speaker, this is important. All the Kenyans who came before us, not a single Kenyan said that we do not have a backup system, Mr. Speaker. In fact, to the contrary, Mr. Speaker, what Kenyans...
What is it, Senator Tangula? Hold my time.
Mr. Speaker, you may... Please sit down. We can't both be on our feet.
Order, members. Order, Senator Murkomen. The rules are very clear. Unfortunately, you have to assume your seat when another member has been given.
Mr. Speaker, when I raised earlier on in the morning that we needed the report to debate the matter, none other than the distinguished Senator for Elgeyo Marakwet virulently opposed the application, arguing that we are now in second reading and we are debating the bill before the House. But what he has been doing, Mr. Speaker, and I want to know if he's in order, is that he has been here taking advantage of his membership of the committee to tell the House who said what at the committee, and is debating a report that we haven't seen, Mr. Speaker. Is he in order?
Order, Senator Murkomen, did you quote from the report?
Not at all, Mr. Speaker. Not at all. I did not mention anything about the report. I said the people who appeared before us. Mr. Speaker, it's my personal observation. It's my personal observation. So, Mr. Speaker, I think that is a contrary and a completely nebulous point of order.
Order, members. Order, Senator Murkomen, I'm afraid the majority leader may be having a point. A matter before the committee cannot be quoted outside the committee until that report is brought. So, and before you ran into trouble, you had already given us your credentials of you and your boss having taught at the university. I am sure you will not miss.
Yeah. Mr. Speaker,
other ways of dealing with the same issue.
Yes, Mr. Speaker, I appreciate your direction. So, Mr. Speaker, a complementary system, and actually a backup system, is necessary in every situation, Mr. Speaker.
I mean, how can my time end?
Order, members, there are many points of order. Let me grant the Deputy Majority Leader 2 minutes.
Only two?
2 minutes. So that you learn not to invite trouble.
That is, Mr. Speaker, anyway. So, Mr. Speaker,
what is it, Mr. Orengo?
Mr. Speaker, I'm very much concerned with your generosity, because people who speak at the beginning have 10 minutes. And if you begin becoming generous to the people who have 10 minutes,
if you interrupt,
and then towards the end, a motion is moved that, you know, we have 2 minutes or 1 minute. I think equality of arms is important. So those who have the advantage of 10 minutes, the chair should not be overly generous to those who are speaking.
Mr. Speaker,
Order, members. I am a bit surprised that Senator Orengo is worried about my generosity. I thought generosity was a good thing. But you are making the valid point. But you know, if those 10 minutes were used continuously, then I would not be generous. But all of us are alive to the fact that there were many points of interruption on the member on the floor. So I was just giving him additional 2 minutes.
So, Mr. Speaker, in my conclusion,
but the point is made so that the future contributors
Mr. Speaker, for the record, Mr. Speaker, there is the voting And this is important for Kenyans to appreciate that we are voting manually, Mr. Speaker. That, Mr. Speaker, results are announced manually, Mr. Speaker. It's only the question of transmission of results that has been provided for by this bill. And, Mr. Speaker, as a committee, my recommendation, Mr. Speaker, as a Senator of this House, is that the regulations that are going to issue in Article 109 will now be able to capture all the proceedings, Mr. Speaker, that we have discussed here, as to when do you resort to the complementary system, Mr. Speaker, that you are going to apply. So, Mr. Speaker, having sat and listened to Kenyans, both on TV, in the committee, and in many other fora, I have realized, Mr. Speaker, that it was necessary for us to commit this issue to a committee of parliament so that the myths are debunked, the lies are exposed, and the truth will only remain for us to make a decision today. And I stand in this House to celebrate democracy, knowing that, Mr. Speaker, at the end of this session, we will make a determination, a decision as a House, which both sides of the House, Mr. Speaker, sat together and went through the process, and, Mr. Speaker, ultimately, using democratic processes, all of us who are elected here, Mr. Speaker, including yourself, Mr. Speaker, will go through a process of voting also in this House to make a determination as to the right position that we need to take as a nation when it comes to this system that we need as a backup. Mr. Speaker, I am very elated and I am very encouraged that, Mr. Speaker, this House has this great opportunity to once again, in a very sober, in a very, Mr. Speaker, intelligent manner, demonstrate to Kenyans that we can agree or disagree, but in the process, we must uphold the principles of democracy, which says that the majority will have their say, but the majority will have their way, and majority will have their say. With those few remarks, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to say I second this bill, and I urge my colleagues to support the bill, Mr. Speaker, that is before this House. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I second.
Order, Senators, I therefore wish to propose the question, which is that the Election Laws Amendment No. 3 Bill, National Assembly Bills No. 63 of 2015, be now read a second time. Senator Ongoro. Senator Ongoro, proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, today is a very important day in this country because the bill before us could very well be said to hold the future of this nation. All of us are mature Kenyans who have been here for as long as we have lived. All of us do not have options. We don't have Kenya number one, Kenya number two, or Kenya number three, where any of us can take to. If we destroy Kenya number one, then you can now go to Kenya number two. All of us only have one country and one life and that Kenya is one. Before us is a bill that holds literally the future of this nation. Three quarters of this country are saying no to the proposed amendments, and a quarter of this country are insisting on a process. I want to laud this House, as I did before, for the sobriety with which we handled this matter before. And this matter was then given to a committee of this House to give the public the benefit of participation. And that has now happened. I'm a bit surprised, though, that even before we look at the proposals from the committee, that I have sat here and heard sentiments from members of the Senate stating that actually it does not matter what input the public has already given to the committee and that our positions are heard and confirmed. That is not true, at least not for me. And I believe I'm speaking for many Kenyans. I came here to know, to read, to have the benefit of knowing exactly what the other Kenyans who presented themselves before that Senate committee had to say, and it could very easily change my position. I do not have to have a very firm stand if I can be convinced that a process as important as the system that we want to have for voting and transmission of results, which was the bone of contention in 2007 when I was in this country, and that led to bloodshed, is still coming up. It's like a big giant that is still coming up to swallow our children, and we are actually faced on whether to kill this snake or to allow it to abide. I am here to be convinced, and I'm here to convince the other members on what I think is the right way forward. My only worry is that I am shocked, actually, because in 2013, my side of the coalition were insisting that we go manual. The other side insisted on electronic voting processes. They carried the day, and they had electronic voting system. We contested, and we still do, even the process and the results thereof. But now, because we say we have one country, we conceded and said, actually, they might have a point. Let us then, as a country, have an electronic voting system. I am not aware of any system that can be 50-50. It is either manual or electronic. There is no way, even in any system at all, that you can say, I am either sick or not sick. Either you have malaria or you don't have. You can never be given an underdose of anything. And therefore, I am so shocked that after convincing us, and after everything we went through, that we have now said, I think it makes sense for us as a nation to have a system that is devoid of any...
Mr. Speaker, looking at the time and the communication that you gave, and also the Gazette notice for this sitting, Mr. Speaker, I beg to move, Mr. Speaker, that pursuant to Standing Order 100, subsection 1 and 2, and notwithstanding the provisions of the Standing Order 100, subsection 4, the Senate resolves that the speaking time during the debate on the second reading of the Election Laws Amendment Number 3 Bill be limited as follows. A. The Senate Minority Leader, not more than 20 minutes. B. The mover in replying, not more than 5 minutes. And Mr. Speaker, any other senator speaking, not more than 5 minutes. And that the speaker to vary this further on need basis. And Mr. Speaker, this is because we have only about less than an hour. This is a very important matter, Mr. Speaker, and it would be important that many of the senators are able to have an opportunity, Mr. Speaker, to speak out their point. And therefore, Mr. Speaker, I beg to move. And I ask Senator Zipporah Kitonyi to second.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Realizing what the mover said, I think it's of great importance that I support that we continue with this motion. I support. I second.
What is this, Senator Atangula?
Mr. Speaker, we oppose this procedural motion by the distinguished Senator Fernandi. It is in perpetuation.
Order, Senator Atangula. Assume your seat.
Of a mischief.
I have not yet even proposed the motion. Senator Sang, let me have a copy of the motion.
Thank you.
Other members are therefore wish to propose the question, which is that I beg to move that pursuant to Standing Order 101 and 2, and notwithstanding the provisions of Standing Order 100, paragraph 4, the Senate resolves that the speaking time during the debate on second reading of the Election Laws Amendment Number 3 Bill be limited as follows. A. The Senate minority leader not more than 20 minutes. B. The mover in replying not more than 5 minutes. And C. Any other senator speaking not more than 5 minutes. And the speaker to vary the time on need basis. Senator Batangula.
Mr. Speaker, we oppose this procedure motion and we want to go on record very briefly that this is a fraudulent attempt to truncate debate. The country is watching this House very keenly, not on how you are going to vote, but what you are going to say in furtherance of helping the country remain at peace with itself. Those of us, Mr. Speaker, who have come here armed with a vote and nothing else are the enemies of this country. We want the country, Mr. Speaker, to hear, understand and appreciate why there has been the necessity to bring such a divisive, contentious and hypocritical amendment to the law that is likely to cascade the country back to 2007-2008. We need to say this, Mr. Speaker, by debating this bill fully. And my distinguished young friend from Nandi cannot unilaterally seek to cut away three quarters of my entitlement to debate this bill when I'm ready to debate this bill on behalf of the people who are not represented here and the people whom we sit with on this side who may not have a chance to speak, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we oppose this procedural motion. A mechanism must be found, Mr. Speaker, to expand the debating time, and if it is not possible, we are ready for you to gazette another sitting tomorrow for us to come and debate this matter fully and inform Kenyans on the mischief that this Jubilee government wants to visit on this country.
Senator Kilonzo Jr.
Mr. Speaker, in the last sitting, I requested for your direction on Standing Order number 29-5. And Mr. Speaker, your direction was that you called us because this matter is urgent and exceptional. That's why you recalled us from our holiday. Mr. Speaker, I want to report that the committees have not even had a wink. We have been working overnight. So therefore, Senator Sang, maybe because he wants to go and sleep, Mr. Speaker, to now limit debate to 5 minutes on matters that are such grave matters, Mr. Speaker. Even by the time I mention amendment to Section 44A, Mr. Speaker, those are 2 minutes. Mr. Speaker, in this particular circumstance, I'm afraid, Mr. Speaker, even if we have to sit overnight, sit tomorrow, the day after, Mr. Speaker, we have already sacrificed our holidays. We have come for a special sitting. If our colleagues want to go, Mr. Speaker, allow us to debate for as long as we can, Mr. Speaker. The country is watching. The country is watching, not for us to vote, Mr. Speaker. Because out there, Mr. Speaker, there is a misconception, Mr. Speaker, that we are talking about different things. The debate here, Mr. Speaker, will correct those impressions. So therefore, Mr. Speaker, Senator Sang must wait for us to speak and listen carefully, Mr. Speaker. Because today, Mr. Speaker, we are going to talk. And you shall listen. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.